Everybody, welcome to another episode in my geography practical series. Today I will be looking at the same map of the Lesser Antilles, Point Michel, right, with a scale of 1 to 25,000. Now I will be going through how you practically wrap up a land description, let's say for a question which asks you to look at the topographic map and to actually describe it. Now, okay, so the first thing you must note is that every map tend to have or should have five key elements. The five key elements of a map is one, border, right? The border. Every map should be nicely bordered. Right, whether you have a sketch map, a topographic map, a climatic map, or a chloropic map, whatever map you have, every map must have a border. Number two, every map should have a title, and the title should be so precise that you can actually use it to actually locate where you're looking at. Okay, so you have two key elements of a map so far. Number three, every map should have a scale. Topography map normally have a, what you call a linear scale, right? Scales can come with different measurements in miles, meters, kilometers, or should I say kilometers, right? So that's another thing that we must bear in mind. Now, in addition to the border, the title, the scale, every map must have this meaning the north symbol, right? Now you have three different types of north. You have magnetic north, true north, and grid north. Okay, so map should have this, right? Normally it is normally located beside the key or near the title, one out of the two. It depends on the type of map that you have. Now, the number four key element in which a map should have is what you call a key. Now, what is the key? The key is that section of the map that helps you to interpret the signs, symbols, or shall I say abbreviations that exist on the map. For example, surface road, red. Okay, when you look at the map, surface road, red. That means this road is well surfaced, what you call a class A road for some persons, right? And so forth, right? You will practically learn as you go along. All right, now in going forward, we'll be looking at describing landscape. Now, when describing a landscape, there's no set rule as to which direction you move. However, I have always advocated with my students that you move from inland to the coastline. So, in looking at this map, you see where in which, it would be more sensible to move from a northern direction to a southern direction. Or, you could move from a eastern direction to a western direction. Okay, when describing a map, you should have the description of some key areas on a map. For example, you want to know about the landscape. You want to know whether or not the land is hilly, is flat, is slopy, is concave or convex. You want to also note, that's practically the topography, right? The landscape, the relief, right? You also want to know the sediment pattern. You want to know transportation, meaning you want to look at the modes of transportation. Are there airports there? Are there ports there? Are there roadways there? Are there other ways in which persons actually move around, such as railway and subway, right? These are considered underneath communication,
So you talk about communication is not necessary. Talking about having a phone call, it's talking about movement, the ability of persons to move from one area to the next and by what means. Okay, so we are finished with that. The next thing that you need to note when you are actually describing a landscape is drainage. Now, drainage comes with several other things that is of paramount, like it's influenced by several other things, such as vegetation and landscape. But for now, let us look at drainage by itself. Now, we have about 5 or 6 different types of drainage. Right, we have parallel drainage pattern, dendritic drainage pattern, radial drainage pattern, chilis drainage pattern, to name a few. Right, throughout the Caribbean, we normally observe that there are drainage patterns such as radial, dendritic, chilis, and you might have a few parallel, right? But not all drainage pattern can be seen within the Caribbean. Alright, so you need to look at the drainage pattern, right? And the drainage is mainly highlighted with blue. As you can see here on the key, blue signifies water course, dam, or pond, right? So as you look at the map, you will see a lot of blue little lines that signifies the drainage pattern. Now, you want to look where the main drainage systems actually is located. For example, you want to know when looking at a landscape, you want to know what's the name of the river, the biggest river, or should I say the river that every other river actually branch off from. You want to know the direction in which the rivers actually move, right? If it moves from east to west direction, north to south direction, easterly direction, it depends on how the landscape is actually carved. All right, so here, so far of importance when describing a map similar to this, you look for features such as landscape, whether or not the land is concave, convex. Oh, and I forgot to share this with you. You can tell concave and convex by virtue looking at the contours, right? Once contours are on the map, you can easily tell whether or not the land is flat, steep, or gentle sloping, right? Also, you can tell, have an idea as to whether or not you have significant features such as volcanoes within this space. For example, let's look at this map, right? Let's look at this area. Looking at this area, one can identify that there is a volcano here. Why is there a volcano here? Or something that looks like a volcano, or a landscape that suggests that there is a volcano. One, this area is a high-rise area with steep sides, right? This can be seen as a result of the closeness of the contours on the map, right? Also, you notice that around this area, right, you have a lot of blue markings which signify that something is flowing from this area, which suggests that it's a radial drainage system. And radial drainage system normally originate or normally occur in areas that has have volcanoes, or something to that effect, where in which you had the a volcano that existed years ago. The volcano top blows off and it falls nearby, forming into what you call a caldera lake. And normally this area is supplied with water as a result of underground system, and gradually it becomes like a little pond that's releasing water in several directions. Okay, so you can identify it by just looking at it, right? So this is like a radial drainage system. And if you look at the entire map, you will realize that there's a lot of systems looking like this. And on the system, well, on the landscape, one identify that there is no settlement, right? No buildings exist. which just points to the fact that something have discouraged persons from actually constructing their houses around here. It could be the steepness of the land, it could be a volcano, it could be the fact that the area is not proper and fitting for housing development, right? But most of what I'm saying is just based on speculation as to what I've seen. All right, so here we look at transportation. We look at transportation, right? Transportation means roads, railway, subway, ports, airports, to name a few. These are some ways in which you communicate. And as I shared with you before, the blue markings on the map signify drainage system. So you have several rivers that exist within this space, and each river or each drainage system, they actually highlight, or should I say, they have a particular drainage system, right? And so far, I have identified a radial drainage system on this map. Okay, so in addition to transportation, in addition to drainage, in addition to communication, which is seen as transportation, we also need to bear in mind that on a map, we look for vegetation. Now, vegetation is divided up into two groups. You have what you call cultivated vegetation and natural vegetation. Now, cultivated vegetation are that vegetation that is actually planted as a result of agriculture. You plant crops like yam, banana, all of those things, and they are reaped and sold, right? And then you have natural vegetation such as swamps, mangroves, forests, grassland, savanna, to name a few, right? Woodland. These are what you call natural vegetations, right? So in describing a landscape, you have to look at that and how you identify the natural versus the cultivated. Again, you need to look at your key, right? Your key will tell you whether or not you have natural vegetation, or you have cultivated vegetation, right? Now, in addition to vegetation, when describing a map, when focused on a map, giving description on a map, you also look for what you call buildings, settlements, how they are organized. Now, we've been doing a topic on settlement, but for now, let us just look at settlement patterns, right? Now, settlements are normally constructed along areas that are gently sloping to flat, right? Notice the center of the map, you don't have any buildings. You might have a one building or a two building here or there, but you do not have a host of buildings like what you would see in the towns that are mostly located along the coastline. And there are reasons for this, right? That we will talk about more in the next year, where we talk about settlements in its entirety. But for now, we're talking about land description. We're talking about how you go about describing. Now, when describing land on a topographic map, as I said before, you have to start from somewhere and end somewhere. You cannot just talk about the entire map one time. So moving from eastern direction to a western direction, one can see several types of vegetation. This vegetation is mixed between natural and cultivated vegetation. Cultivated vegetation include plantations such as coconut and other food-like items that are grown on farms and are sold within the local market. Natural vegetation include woodlands, swamps, mangroves, right? So you would actually share in the description of the land in sentence format, right? Using proper sentences and constructing it appropriately, right? So that it's sound linguistically correct. So what have we looked at so far? We have looked at the fact that you have components of a map. You have the title, the border, the key, the north symbol, and we also have what you call the scale. In addition to all of that, right, we can also identify on a map that we have different aspects such as the vegetation, landscape, drainage, right, settlements, right, special features such as ponds, right. In addition to that, we can also identify coastal features such as coastal cliffs, right. We can also identify beaches, right. We can also identify bays, right. We can also identify headlands, and if possible, we might even can identify some tombolos. I can't pronounce the word properly, but you get what I'm saying, right? It might be a little bit difficult for you to identify stack and stump and arch from this angle. However, diagrams are probably drawn a different way. Probably you could. Thank you very much for stopping by. I hope that this is a brief explanation as to how you go about describing features on a map, describing a map in its entirety, works out. A question like this can value between 4 and 6 marks in exam. So, as you go forward, these are what you need to look for, right? You need to look at the scale, you need to look at the title of the map, vegetation of the map, communication, coastal feature, and also settlements, right? Thank you very much for stopping by. Bye-bye for now. Catch you next time. Peace.